Our special guest today is someone who is well known to most of us, especially those who enjoy films and enjoy them seeing them reviewed with satirical bite. He is, of course, Barry Norman. Welcome, Barry. I'd like to start, if I may, by going back to... you left Highgate School and went straight into regional journalism. Then I understand you didn't find that particularly rewarding, so you went to Africa. Now, why was that?
Oh, well, it's simply that I went to work on a weekly paper in Kensington, where I earned, it's a long time ago, I earned about £3.05 a week. It's ridiculous, isn't it? And because I'd only been there about a year, I couldn't get a better job anywhere else in England. But I had a friend who was working in Johannesburg, and being politically naive in those days, I thought Johannesburg would be a nice place to go to. And he put me in touch with a chain of newspapers over there, and they were offering me about £9 a week, so I went. It was as simple as that, a straight commercial transaction. Also, I think, you know, I felt it was a good idea to get away from home since I decided not to go to university. I thought it'd be a good idea to get away from home, live by myself for a couple of years.
It was presumably on the experience that you gained working on a newspaper in Johannesburg that you got the job with the Daily Mail.
Well, I came back after about 2.5 years. I didn't go straight to the Mail, I went to the Sketch, and the reason I went to the Sketch is a sort of boy gossip writer, because there was a girl in London that I wanted to keep in close contact with, and the only other jobs I was offered at that time were out of London. It didn't seem a good idea, so I stayed in London on the Daily Sketch. Whether that was a smart idea or not, I don't know.
You eventually ended up with the Mail and became show business editor of the Mail.
Yeah.
But then when the Sketch and the Mail merged, you found yourself redundant. How did you feel?
Insulted, actually. Insulted and very angry. And I think in retrospect that that's the best way to feel if you're redundant, because, you know, if you feel downcast and you think, my God, they've thrown me out, I can't be any good, then you probably aren't any good, and at least you won't be, you know, you've screwed it for yourself. But if on the other hand you say, my God, look what the fools have done now, they, you know, they can't tell stalk from butter, and you go out and try and prove that they couldn't tell stalk from butter, I think it helps. Mind you, it's easier if you're a freelance journalist, because, you know, a freelance journalist can get in touch with the paper and say, you know, can I come in and do some freelance subbing? But you can't go to ICI and say, can I come and do some freelance managing directing for you, because they don't
sell them. Well, I heard from the current features editor of The Guardian, Harry Jackson, that you did fit in with The Guardian, and you actually wrote some leaders for The Guardian, which he describes as with an unusual tone of levity. Do you remember that?
Well, I do, yes, because what happened was that when I got redundant and nobody offered me a job, so I decided I'd have to be a freelance journalist. And Bernard Levin, among other people, and quite unknown to me, wrote to people like Alastair Hetherington, who was then the editor of The Guardian, to say that, you know, if you're employing any of the redundant Daily Mail people, this one's unlikely to rape the managing director's wife or get drunk and be sick on your carpet, so he might be all right. So I went in to see Hetherington about 9:30 one night, and he, apart from what Bernard had written to him, he really didn't know anything about me, because I realised now that the big name you think you've built up on a popular paper actually doesn't mean much outside the popular paper. And he'd somehow got the idea that I was a leader writer, and I tried to disabuse him of this because I was a show business writer. And he finally said, well, look, go away, think about it for a week, come back next week and tell me if you want to write leaders for us. So I went away and I read Guardian leaders, and I thought, no, I don't, I can't write this stuff, you know, I mean, they're all terribly learned. So I came back to tell him I couldn't do leaders for him. And his secretary said, oh, Mr. Hetherington's expecting you. So I was ushered into this room where the leader writers of The Guardian were all having a conference. And they looked at me in some surprise, because they had no idea who I was or what I was doing there. Neither did I. And they all went through their proposed ideas for leaders, like, you know, the Russo-Chinese détente and the state of the economy in the Balkans and God knows what. And then finally it came to me, and Hetherington said, have you got any ideas for a leader? And all I really wanted to say was no, and can I go home, please? But I felt I couldn't do that. So I came up with some daft idea. And the others looked at me with great astonishment. It was some kind of women's lib idea based on a story that a woman in Sicily had put her husband in a chastity belt. And I went off and wrote a leader about it. That happened. It just happened like that. And for about the next 4 months, I came in 2 or 3 times a week to write leaders.
Incredible. I understand.
Incredible's the word, yeah.
I understand from your television producer that you're the odd one out of your family in terms of work in the film industry. I think, your father was Leslie Norman, who directed and produced films.
Mm-hmm.
Your mother was involved in films, your sister, your brother-in-law, your wife even. But you've stayed on the kind of periphery, just reviewing them. Have you ever had any ambitions to get deeply involved with the making of a film?
Well, when I left school, what I really wanted to do then was to go into the film industry in the cutting rooms, which is really the way my father had learned. And I still think the best editors, the best directors, are the people who've come up through the cutting rooms, because they've got a kind of economy of style and line. So that's what I wanted to do, but the film industry was in one of its periodic slumps at the time. And curiously enough, journalism looked fairly healthy, and I had a certain knack of putting words together in a fairly readable way. So it was decided in a family conference that I shouldn't go in the film industry, I should go into journalism. And for about 5 years, I was sorry, in a way, because I kept wishing I was back in the movie, or I was in the movie industry. And then after a while, I decided I wasn't sorry at all, and I'm quite happy not to be involved in it.
Well, you now present Film 77 on the BBC. One often watches you as though you relish destroying a particularly bad film. Now, yeah, I mean, what gives you more pleasure, watching a good film or pulling to pieces a bad film? Or is that an unfair question?
No, a perfectly fair question. I get pleasure out of watching good films. I don't actually get pleasure out of pulling down a bad film, but I do feel that if you are a critic, what is a critic? A critic really ought to be somebody who's interested in the standards of the medium which he's criticising. But I think to some extent you've got to be something of an entertainer yourself, because if you're a dull critic, nobody's going to bother listening to you. So I don't actually get pleasure out of pulling down a rotten movie. But I get a certain amount of pleasure out of writing something which I think is amusing about it.
Yeah. Do you think you have any impact on the film industry? Do you think that people really take notice?
I honestly don't know. I mean, there are certain people in Water Street who think I ought to be banned from reviewing films and hate me. But in a way, that's a compliment, because I don't feel I'm there to puff the film industry. You know, I'm the first loyalty, really, is to the viewer, who is presumably interested in finding out what a film is like before he spends his money on it. So I feel that I must be honest about the film as far as the viewer is concerned. I think some people actually go and see films on my recommendation, and sometimes they upbraid me bitterly afterwards. And other people miss films. I don't think too many people stay away from films because of me. I never advise anybody to stay away from a film, but I do often urge them to go and see a picture. But the perfect example of how little effect one can have sometimes was a film called, it was Confessions of a Window Cleaner, which I thought was terrible. But we always showed a good clip from any film we're reviewing. So otherwise, you've got a boring programme for showing boring clips. So I did a send-up of this film, showed a very good clip. The next day, a chauffeur came to pick me up to take me off somewhere. And he said, I saw your programme last night. And I said, yeah, what do you think of it? And he said, that Confessions of a Window Cleaner, that looked a good movie. So he obviously hadn't taken any notice of what I said.
I see. Well, we're slowly running out of time. I'd like to ask you finally about your other interest, which is writing novels, I understand. Mm. You've got a novel coming out next month. Can you quickly tell us what it's about?
Well, it's a modern sort of comedy about a guy who reaches the age of 35 and decides that his life is actually coming to an end, and he's a failure, he's got nowhere, he's never going to get anywhere. And it's what happens to him after that. I think it's very amusing. I hope it's amusing. It's supposed to be.
Well, we look forward to it. Barry Norman, thank you very much.